This week on the Mr. Throwback Thursday podcast, we bring you A Fresh in Peace, some wrestling crossover, surprise, Fat Joe goes to Washington, not all business is good business, and some lunatic is claiming that he created all musical styles of the last two decades. What else? Let's listen.
It's not just any day. It's Mr. Throwback Thursday.
All you kids want to get on and shit.
You are now about to witness the strength of street knowledge.
Help, I'll be dead.
At the count of three, I want y'all to tell me the name of my DJ. One, three.
Let the poppers pop and the breakers break. Let the fellas say ho and the girls say hey. Give it up for the DJ, Mr. Throwback Thursday.
And now, here's your hosts, Bill Winters. And Mr. Throwback Thursday himself, Jamie Robinson.
Schlanta, everybody.
Indeed.
And welcome to Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 521. As we are recording, it's St. Patrick's Day.
It is. And I don't have my St. Patrick's Day mug, but I do have my old English
mug.
Oh,
you went with the old English mug. I went with the 10th anniversary mug today.
Well, I figured, you know, maybe I'll put some green food coloring in a 40 and I'll have, you know,
some type of green beer ball. Nice. Well, welcome to Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 529. It will not be St. Patrick's Day when you hear this.
No.
But for today, your two hosts are Pat McGroin and Patio Furniture.
Indeed.
How's that? Now, Bill up in New York. Jamie down in Virginia. How are you, my friend?
I am well. You know, had a good, how do we put, you shouldn't really just say we had a good betting day yesterday, because, you know, we shouldn't encourage that. But we made out on some wagers yesterday that went very well for us.
I very rarely wager anymore.
Yes, I know. I, on the other hand, am a junkie. So I.
But I had a feeling about yesterday's game and I had a couple of extra bucks. So I put $2.50 on the Rangers game and I actually won on it.
Yes, you did.
Yes.
I won on the same game.
And then took over my PA announcing duties for the Hudson Valley Vipers. And as I was telling you, a 14-4 victory for our team between 18 goals and 20 penalties in the game. I'm shocked I even have a voice this morning.
That almost sounds like the Ranger game from yesterday.
There was a lot of scoring in that game.
There was a lot of scoring.
Anyway.
Yes.
We have a full docket for Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 529.
I'd like to make sure we do. We got to fill 2 hours of radio time, you know.
We don't get to use the word docket very much.
We do not.
So I wanted to use.
It's like
bollocks. Oh, we use that plenty. So
I see us using that plenty in the future.
Yes, because, well, I mean, bollocks is an English word, isn't it?
It is, yes.
Not necessarily an Irish word.
No,
I think the Irish word is just fuck. The Irish are great at using that word as every word in a sentence. Yes. It can be a noun, a verb, an adjective.
As a sailor.
This is a legitimate Irish sentence. Fuck that fucking fucker.
Yes.
There you go. Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 529. Standard stuff today. We have hip hop headlines. We have some woo news, which a very easy one for me to do the stylized talking on today, which is good.
I was
going to
make
that.
It really difficult, and I went, I'll just go this way.
You knew I had a rough day yesterday. Is that what it was? A one and done that I haven't heard in a long, long time.
It's been a while.
A record of the week that. Another underappreciated MC.
I will go with that.
We'll remind you who the artist of the month is. We do have an old to the new this week.
Nobody told us we could have it, but I took it.
But it's out there. So if it's out there, it's fair game.
Yes.
I will read lyrics and then we'll put a bow on episode 529. So we don't have any giveaways or anything today, as far as I know.
No, I'm low on shipping costs. I gotta wait till Patreon comes through.
I was going to say, we got to wait for that Patreon money to come in.
That's why John and Sarah still don't have their winnings from 2 weeks ago. I do have it. It's sitting right here next to me.
And at least they won something and not just Ken.
So. Yes.
So would you be so kind to get us started with a little bit of that Triple H, please?
Yay, yay.
Don't stop, facts with the real hip hop.
This is Hip Hop Headlines, brought to you by Mr. Throwback Thursday.
Well, get on it. It's your time.
It is my toin, and we're going to start with a fresh in peace this week. And this one came through on a lot of different channels.
Yes.
One of the pioneers, the first female artist ever signed to Def Jam Records.
Yeah.
Lachelle Marie Laws, professionally known as Boss. With two stylized dollar signs for the S's.
She was out of Detroit, right? Originally. I know
that
she repped Def Jam West, but...
Right. So if she was still alive and we were having fun with it, we would call her Bo dollar sign, but she is Boss. She was 56 years old.
And she's had a lot of problems. We've actually talked about Boss on here.
Mm-hmm.
She had a GoFundMe for her kidney issues.
Right.
I believe she had a stroke since we've been doing this show.
Yeah. Yeah. She's battled. Her best known album, Born Gangstas.
Mm-hmm. With the song Deeper.
Mm-hmm. Laws, in a statement posted to Instagram, Boss, clad in sunglasses, head to toe Carhartt, Def Jam wrote, "We are deeply saddened by the passing of Lachelle Marie Laws, also known as Boss. Boss will be remembered as a pioneer in hip hop, being one of the first female rappers signed to Def Jam in the early 90s. We extend our prayers and condolences to her family and loved ones during this wild time." According to a GoFundMe set up by her family in 2011, she had renal disease. She suffered a stroke in 2017, like you said. At the time of her death, she was in need of a procedure that would have made it possible for her to have another procedure to get a kidney transplant.
Finally get a transplant,
But she, it almost sounds like, and I hate to say this because I'm not a firm believer in that sort of thing, but when you're in that much pain and physical, it almost sounds like torture.
Yeah. Yeah, she was talking about one time how many medications she had to take just for her kidneys.
Yeah.
And it was like 40 something pills a day or something like that just for her kidneys.
Yeah, which is just crazy. She was found by Def Jam, at the time, co-founder Russell Simmons, because she had collaborated on Word to the Motherfucking DJ Quick.
Yes.
And he put her on to Russell Simmons, and Russell Simmons signed her to Def Jam for the West Coast division. Mm-hmm. First woman to sign with the West Coast. We talked about Born Gangsta. Mm-hmm. That was produced by Jam Master Jay,
Def
Jeff, and others. Very successful record. Deeper was the big single that you talked about. That peaked at number one on the hot rap track. So, Boss was a no nonsense MC.
Yeah,
that's for sure.
She caught a lot of shit. They were saying that she was like a fake gangster and whatnot, and that was kind of what derailed her success. People were calling her out, saying, you grew up in you're from Cranbrook. You went to Cranbrook. Yeah. It's a private, it was that kind of thing.
She's from a middle class neighborhood. How could she be gangster?
Right. But her whole album was her poking fun at the gangster mentality.
Yeah. And she stated, she goes in an interview, she says, there's gangsters all over the place.
Right.
There's gangsters that went to Harvard in the business world. Yeah. Doesn't make them any less gangster just because they're in a different spot.
Yeah. Ed Young's a gangster.
Ed Young is a gangster.
He went to Harvard,
He did. And now he's the gangster of Toontown.
Yes, he is.
We haven't seen Ed in a while. We're going to have to get him back on the show. I miss Ed. She battled. She battled some serious stuff. And
like a gangster, like a boss.
She was talking about, she was in the process of possibly releasing another full length project. And she says, when my record comes out, I'm going to pack up my kidney pills, the 45 I have 45, to take every day and go wherever. So, wow.
Premier posted something when she died. Basically, he said he did a song with her.
Mm-hmm.
And Def Jam has it, and he's asking them to release it.
I never knew that.
We'll have to look for that. Yeah. So, all right. But unfortunately, boss Lachelle Laws, dead at the age of 56. And the Mr. Throwback Thursday podcast extends our sympathies and condolences to the friends, fans, and family of boss.
Yay, yay!
Our next article, a little bit of a wrestling crossover. Now, if anybody has followed wrestling in the past few years, you are aware. Or has
listened to this show, because we had mentioned when she was in WWE, we mentioned the familial
name. Yes.
Connection. Yes.
He actually.
And the greatest splash of all time. No, that was in AEW.
Yeah. we're talking about Mercedes Varonato, known professionally by a couple of different names, yes. Formerly known as Sasha Banks, currently known as Mercedes Moné.
Yes.
She made her debut in AEW, All Elite Wrestling, as the CEO character.
Mm-hmm.
She is cousins with one Calvin Broadus.
She is
Calvin Broadus, who you know as Snoop,
the owner of the greatest splash in history.
Yes. So she made her debut there. Her first merch references her cousin Snoop's Death Row Records.
Yes.
Which is kind of cool.
Although, you know, the wording on it, like the whole layout of her stuff is very reminiscent of Death Row.
Yeah.
But her catchphrase on that shirt.
Yeah.
Is very bad boy.
It's very bad boy. Yeah. It's, and you know, I'm not sure what the big S is in the middle. She's Mercedes Moné.
Right.
She's not Sasha.
She is not.
And the S kind of looks like from the source.
It does. It very much look like that.
So, I mean, there's a whole lot of things that you can pick apart. If you're a wrestling fan, and I am a wrestling fan,
yes.
Have been for a long time. I am not the biggest fan of Mercedes, mm-hmm. per se. I think there's female wrestlers who are better on the mic and better, you know, she has talent, but, you know, not everybody can be everybody's cup of tea. And that's the beauty of wrestling.
But the reason she's here on this show, though,
is because she's cousins with Snoop Dogg. Right. So, this is this T-shirt that she released has the Death Row stylized letters.
It does.
But it says Mo Money, no problems.
Yes. So which is a cool catchphrase with her name.
Yeah.
But it is very much a bad boy.
Yeah.
So she's putting bad boy and Death Row together. She is solving the East West battle from the 90s, mm-hmm. with one shirt.
And her cousin, by the way, I think has more WrestleMania victories than she does.
I'm sorry. I don't want to say he only has splash. He's got an incredible elbow, too.
Yes, he did the people's elbow.
Yes.
Oh, God, that was so. Yeah, Snoop, because of Mercedes being involved in it, is mm-hmm. very involved in wrestling as well. I hope she sells a shit ton of T-shirts. You know, a lot of these people make a lot of their money off of their merch.
Oh, yeah.
Although she got a pretty good guaranteed contract coming over there. Yeah. So, Mercedes is, she's raking in the Moné.
Well, she's
for sure.
The CEO. So
she's the CEO. Yep. They started chanting CEO and everything, probably because her new theme mm-hmm. starts with a CEO chant. So I think it was pretty much a Pavlovian response. Yeah.
Okay.
But yes. Donnie Mercury for life. Donnie Mercury is the hottest attraction in pro wrestling.
That's what I hear. I actually have a shirt that says that.
I know.
Cranky has a shirt that says that.
Mm-hmm. I can't wait for the Donnie Mercury debut in a major federation someday. So congratulations to Mercedes Varonato and her cousin Snoop on hopefully a very lucrative partnership.
And I'm assuming that he allowed her to use the Death Row stylizing because he owns it and all.
I would think, yeah.
Unless you ask the guy who's spending a night in prison, he still thinks that he owns it. But
well, he also thinks if you can't see, you should drive a truck.
This is true. And he prefers syrup.
Next article. Go to on his nuts?
Yes.
Is that what you wanted? As soon as I read it, I said, I have to do it that way or he's going to be very disappointed.
Yeah, I would have stopped you and gone, wait, do it again.
And this comes to us from nationaljeweler.com.
Which I believe is a new source.
And, you know, hello, Ken. Good
morning, Ken.
We're not giving anything away today.
So you don't have to like, stay.
Goodbye, gents. He says, hi, gents.
Holler.
A celebration of hip hop jewelry is coming to a museum in New York City.
Yeah.
Ice Cold, an exhibition of hip hop jewelry opens at the New York City Museum on May 9th. The American Museum of Natural History. So it's not just any museum.
No, it's
one
deal.
Of the big ones.
Yeah.
Of course, last year was the 50th anniversary of hip hop. So arriving on the heels, they're going to do an exhibition of hip hop jewelry featuring dozens of jewelry pieces, tracing the history of the genre from the 1980s all the way through current. May 9th, it's going to open in the museum's Allison and Roberto Mignon Halls of Gems and Minerals.
Hmm.
It's going to dive into hip hop's cultural influence through jewelry worn by some of the iconic stars of the genre, beginning with the oversized gold chains embraced in the 1980s, the good old Dookie chains.
Yes. How much for the 30-inch Dookie?
Highlights of the exhibition include Slick Rick's gem-encrusted crown,
mm-hmm.
the notorious B.I.G.'s legendary gold Jesus piece, a diamond-studded Rockefeller Records medallion for the record label co-founded by Hawaiian Sophie, Nicki Minaj's Barbie pendant, pieces from Erykah Badu,
ooh, the Voodoo Queen,
A$AP Rocky, Joey Badass, A$AP Ferg, and Tyler, the Creator. Whole lot of dollar signs in this week's show.
Yes.
We had Boss, B-O, Boss. Dollar sign. Oh. We had Bo, dollar sign.
Yep.
We had A, dollar sign, app Rocky.
Yep.
We have Joey Bada, dollar sign. And we have A, dollar sign, app Ferg so yeah. far.
Got them all. Now that the Ferg is, again, not the Kids Incorporated Stacey Ferguson.
No,
who became the Fergie
from Black Eyed Peas,
yes.
who they summarily dismissed.
Yes, she gone.
So Sean Decatur, the president of the American Museum of Natural History, says these jewelry pieces are not just magnificent in and of themselves. They're an important part of hip hop history and hip hop culture as artists claimed and transformed traditional symbols of luxury and success. And you know what? A lot of the album covers we used to be gravitated to, the jewelry on that was a big thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you look and you say, oh man, look at the chain on this. The first thing I noticed on Slick Rick was the bejeweled eye patch.
Yeah.
And the big chain.
Well, of course,
and the gold teeth and yeah,
tons of chains for Rick. He looked like Mr. T.
Yeah, he did. But he was MC Ricky D.
Yes, yes.
Not Mr. T.
It is part of his costume when he gets ready to go on stage.
Mm-hmm.
Like he comes up and there's a guy, his chain guy, who puts all of his stuff on him before he walks out on stage. So he didn't have to carry all that around with him.
You know, there's a book, too.
Yes.
Called Ice Cold, the Hip Hop Jewelry History, published in 2022. Many of the pieces that are going to be displayed in the American Museum of Natural History are in this book. It was written by Vicky Toback, which also features a foreword from Slick Rick. And essays by $APFerg, LL Cool J, Kevin Lee, known as Coach K, and Pierre Thomas, just known as P. But this ain't no motherfucking P.
It ain't no motherfucking P.
So starting May 9th, if you're in the New York City area and
I will not
you
be, but
feel like it, go to the American Museum of Natural History. You know what? The funny thing about the museums is they don't cost anything to get into. They just recommend donations.
Right, right.
So we usually go toward the city sometime around our anniversary, mm-hmm. which is May 4th.
I say it was the week
although
before
I
that.
think we're gonna be up in Saratoga at the time. But you know, if we head down to the city, I might shoot into the Museum of Natural History and see if I can't get some photos of the exhibit. Yeah.
See, we are like the Museum of Natural History. We are free. We also recommend donating.
Yes. Very good. That's us. And I'm as big as the building now. So that's fine. Next article. What are you doing in the White House?
If you're not selling cocaine. Just ask your wife,
Nancy
Reagan.
And there's a lot of people who are asking that of current residents of the White House, too.
That's all I can think of is, what are you doing in the White House?
If you're not selling cocaine. It's another dollar sign
there.
I was going to say that before. The only one we're missing is $2 sign Hort.
Well, now we got him.
Today, we are clocking lots of dollars.
We all got gold.
They all got gold. It's going to be on display at the American Museum of Natural History. Will they be
cruising in their Benz?
And there is your full circle moment. I don't know. I usually take public transportation out of Benz when I get down there. Getting back to the article, Rock the Bells brings us this. Fat Joe has met in the White House on March 15th with, not to be confused with James Kamala Harris, with Vice President Kamala Harris to discuss marijuana reform. Yes, because there's a difference in the pronunciation.
Yes.
The Ugandan giant was Kamala.
Yes, which a lot of people pronounce her name that way. Whether intentionally or not.
Yes, her name is truthfully pronounced Kamala.
Right.
So.
Not the Ugandan giant.
No. But it's easier to pronounce Fat Joe.
It is.
Because it's 2 one-syllable words. I can handle that.
Joey Crack.
Fat Joe was at the White House on March 15th to moderate a panel on marijuana reform with Vice President Kamala Harris. And at that table, Vice President Harris acknowledged her own role in what she described as an unequal criminal justice system. Mm-hmm. Which, you know, little accountability is never a bad thing, I guess. Well,
because she's already got the new job up there in the White House, so she can talk about all the things she did wrong when she was in her own state.
I believe that the promise of America includes equal justice under the law, and for too many, our criminal justice system has failed to live up to that core principle. And that's been spouted out by tons of people.
And then she smacked herself on her belly and turned to Friday and, went, and said, take me out of here.
And I say that with full knowledge of how this system has worked, including my experience as a prosecutor. I thank Fat Joe for being here, for taking the time, and for your voice and artistry on so many critical issues, she said.
Like leaning back. And going all the way up. Yeah.
So, it's pretty impressive that Joe made it that far.
Yes.
And two, he's not that fat anymore. So no, he's not. I understand that's his performing name.
Right.
But he's, you know, he's
thinned out.
He's decent shape, Joe, but I don't think that's going to sell very many records. Doesn't work
as well now. He can become PHAT Joe.
He's healthy Joe.
Sloppy Joe. I don't know.
Sloppy Joe. Slop. We'll see if anything comes of it. Yeah. You know, states have been doing their thing.
Yes.
With the marijuana reform. And there's more of a stigma now, I think, on tobacco than there is on weed.
Yeah.
To me, I think they both still smell like cabbage farts.
Well, yeah, but that's why you don't smoke it.
No, I don't.
Ingest it in other forms. That way it doesn't smell bad.
I will say, I have seen the benefits of the edibles specifically for patients that I deal with on a daily basis, plus people in my own personal life. There are a lot of people I know who sleep a lot better at night now just from taking a gummy.
Mm-hmm.
And as somebody who has been in the medical industry now for 13 years, you cannot overvalue how important it is to get proper sleep.
Yeah. Or to be able to walk without knee pain.
Or to be able to see if it helps with cataracts and glaucoma. And I mean, there is a lot of good medicinal use out of it. I just wish it didn't smell like Taco Bell and cabbage farts when you light it up. That's why I like the edibles. Not me personally. I've never taken one, but I prefer the use of edibles for people in the proper settings. And I'll get off my soapbox now because I get nosebleeds when I stand up too long. You want to be a rap superstar? Well, we did at one point.
Well, yes.
we were going to put out Saran Wrap. It was going to be our own version of really, really shitty rap music. But Dr. Dre's star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame will live next to Snoop Dogg's. Okay, then.
Yes. Okay, player.
Dre is set to receive his star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame this coming Tuesday. So 2 days after we record and 2 days ago when you're listening on Thursday.
Right.
His star will live next to his longtime friend and collaborator, Snoop, in front of the Jimmy Kimmel studio. Snoop will speak during the ceremony alongside Interscope Records co-founder Jimmy Iovine, the guy who he helped create Beats with that made them billionaires with a B. Radio legend Big Boy with a Y, not to be confused with Big Boy from Outkast,
right,
will serve as the MC. The producer of the Hollywood Walk of Fame is Anna Martinez, and she said in a statement that Dr. Dre's contributions to the music industry are undeniable and have left an indelible mark on popular culture. As a producer, rapper, and entrepreneur, Dr. Dre has continuously pushed boundaries and set new standards for excellence. It is with great pride that we honor his incredible career and extraordinary impact by awarding him a star on the Walk of Fame. And I guarantee that Dee Barnes will not be at that ceremony.
You would think she probably won't be allowed there, let alone anything else, because she's been blackballed.
She will defecate on it. She will pull it daylight.
She'll wait till everybody leaves and swing by at night.
and then squeeze one out. Dre's star will serve as a lasting symbol of his immense talent and enduring legacy in the world of music before she deemed his star location special. Of course, it's been a pretty big year so far for NWA alumni. NWA was honored with a Lifetime Achievement Award at the 2024 Who Gives a Fuck About a Goddamn Grammy Awards.
Wasn't that just yellow, though?
Yeah, Dre was unable to accept the award in person. Cube joked he wanted to make sure he a billionaire. He got shit to do
with a B.
You know what? Cube is probably getting close to that B status too with all of his successes.
You would think so. It just the reason that Dre was such a big thing is because it was all at once.
Yeah,
the deal was a $1 billion deal.
Yeah, and
so that's why it's such a notable. Everybody knows it.
Yeah, but out of the two of them, Dre's never been on a Mr. Throwback Thursday mug.
He is not.
Or bowl.
No.
So Cube wins that one.
He does. And I have his pop figure right there.
Yes, you do. But then Cube also said in that same sentence, he goes, "We all love Dre. We wouldn't be here without him. We're grateful for him and his brilliance, his talent, his leadership." And then, and I'm telling you, NWA's had a good year. Just don't go to a show right now if they say NWA, because
it's gonna be yellow.
It's gonna be yellow and some friends of his. So it's, you know, like going to see the Beatles and seeing Ringo and three guys that he got from a garage band. Next article.
The Beatles were anyway.
That's what they started out as, basically. Although they wasn't Pete Best an original Beatle?
I don't know if he was an original. I think he filled in. And then either that or he got Wally pipped. I'm not sure. It was.
I am not up on my Beatles history.
No.
I listen to the Beatles when they come on. I don't necessarily turn them off, but I don't actively search for Beatles music to listen to.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know enough about them, but. You know, again, there's a lot of bands like that.
He said he did. He got wallied.
Okay. That's kind of what I thought happened. But, you know, we are not a Beatles podcast. We are a hip hop podcast.
We are.
And when we talk about hip hop, we're talking about Dame Dash.
We are.
At allhiphop.com. Dame Dash is accusing Hawaiian Sophie of misusing Rockefeller funds in a legal battle over the shares outstanding of the label.
We did mention that, you know, he was probably going to have to sell off his. Yes. In order to pay debts.
Mm-hmm. So Damon Dash has addressed his upcoming public auction that will see him part with his shares in Rockefeller Records, as he claims Hawaiian Sophie's been playing dirty. He says, "I just want to sell it and fund my other businesses with it." The auction stems from a legal obligation to settle an outstanding debt of $832,000 owed to film producer Josh Weber and Muddy Waters Pictures. I think it was about a month ago we talked about this.
Yes.
The origin of the acrimonious dispute goes back to 2016. Dash was relieved of his duties as the director of Weber's crime thriller, Dear Frank, because they're saying allegedly unprofessional behavior. And Dash is like, that's bullshit. Mm-hmm. But he didn't say that in court. He said he categorically denied it, which is legal term for that's bullshit.
And bull pucky.
Judge did not agree with Dame Dash's assessment.
The judge has not been agreeing with Dame Dash at all lately.
And said, you owe him money. 832 large. So Dash has failed to meet these financial obligations, prompting a legal push to liquidate his share in Rockefeller Records to satisfy the debt.
Yeah, there was a big joke going around. You know that Mace and Cameron have a podcast, right? Have you heard this?
I know they have one. I have not listened to it.
Well, they were joking, saying that, you know, saying that they bought Dame's shares of Rockefeller, and like people picked it up and ran with it, and they're like, "Did you hear?" I'm like, "No, that's not what really happened." They were joking about it on their show.
The two of them throwing shit.
Yeah, and people going, "Did you hear what they said?" Run that news article. Well, no, that's why it didn't show up on here.
It's not a news article. Ever since Mace kind of found his voice against Puffy again,
yes,
I've been enjoying Mace a lot more. Murder Mace is back.
Isn't it May $E?
It is May Ma $E.
Look out.
Another dollar sign. Clocking lots of dollars this week. This is ridiculous. How does this happen?
I have no idea.
It's a cosmic thing.
It is. It's not like I put all these articles together and making a theme for a show.
No, they just happen to come across that way. Yes. Now remember that there's still this thing with the bylaws of Rockefeller saying that they can't sell the shares without like board consent.
2/3 majority or something.
But I don't know if that gets trumped by legal precedent. Yeah. I would think I would have to.
Yeah, I would think that if the judge says you will do this, which I don't even know if he can do, but
he's the guy in the black robe. If anybody has any power to say that,
right,
the guy in the black robe does.
Right. I can see him putting a lien on his income from Rockefeller maybe to pay. I don't know if he can force him to sell it, but if he can,
I
don't know.
I mean, bankruptcy courts force you to sell things.
Right. So if he does force, or if he can, whatever, force him to sell it, mm-hmm, can the company then determine who is going to buy it, or are they forced to buy it back from him if they don't want somebody else, random person, owning it? I don't know how that works with their internal bylaws and the external judge decision.
Yeah. Now, in the past, I guess Dash had tried to sell or auction off his shares and sell them as an NFT.
I remember that.
That was blocked by Hawaiian Sophie.
By the board, yeah.
And Dash said in an interview, he accused Sophie of assuming the role of CEO of Rockefeller without proper authority and using the company's resources against
him. CEO of the ROC, isn't that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So Dame says, Jay pretended to be the CEO of Rockefeller, hired his lawyers on Rockefeller Inc.'s behalf. They illegally tried to change bylaws. Jay's using my money to pay his lawyers to sue me about something I did not do. That sounds like a sitcom.
That's how he could make his money.
Or a Law and Order thing. Jay-Z and the other co-owner of Rockefeller, who I believe is what, Biggs Burke?
Yeah, it's the other guy.
Biggs Burke. The other guy, yeah. The one nobody knows.
Right.
Yes, Biggs Burke. Hawaiian Sophie and Burke were overruled by U.S. Magistrate Judge Robert W. Lerberger, asserting that such bylaws do not supersede legal obligation to satisfy a court judgment. So there you have it.
There.
So Dash says, finally, the judge was like, yo, he could sell his interest. Those bylaws that you put in 2021 are not applicable. You can't tell that man he can't sell his private property. So now I get to take it to auction like I originally wanted to. Now it's like I got an order of protection against Jay and Biggs from trying to put a lawsuit on me.
Because the judge said so.
Yes.
Judge Judy? Because then Jay would let it go through if it was Judge Judy who made that call.
Because he loves to watch some Judge Judy. We talked about that. That's another one making a lot of money.
Yeah.
Judge Judy's rich as fuck, man.
That's why she got a new show.
She doesn't have to be Judge Judy anymore.
No, now it's Judy Justice.
Yes. Making billions.
Don't go to the Row.
Yeah. Now, this is the old Row, not the new Row, because the new Row, you know, they just
they probably would go to because of yes, because I would go to something under run new by management. Snoop. Yes. Friend of the show, Fredro Starr.
Yes.
Says that Tupac warned him not to accept Suge Knight's death row offer years ago.
Okay.
Fredro said that he was subtly warned that signing
subtly
with Marion was a bad idea. In an interview with the Art of Dialogue that dropped last Throwback Thursday, the friend of the show and Onyx co-rhymer.
Yes.
Recalled a moment with Pac and Suge at the premiere of the movie Sunset Park.
I remember Sunset Park. I haven't watched that in a long time.
You know, that might eventually end up being a Fresh Flicks, too. Rhea we could Perlman add that to the that list. One? I think it did.
Yeah.
Which I had a case of. You know, I had diarrhea, you know, Rhea Perlman at a party celebrating the release of the 1996 film, which starred Fred Rowe and featured Tupac's High Till I Die on the soundtrack. Fred Rowe said that Pac and Suge showed up. Pac, you know, he was like the sun. He said, when he came around, you felt his energy. When he walked in, you could feel the power. At that time, he was the biggest star in hip hop.
I can see that.
The New York City native said after the movie that Suge asked to speak to him privately. Fredro says, me, Pac, and Suge, we take a walk, just us three. Suge was like, I want to sign you to death row. And Fredro said, what are you talking about? Suge had a reputation for being, he says, let's compare the energy. If Pac is the sun, Suge is the moon. He got that dark energy. So when he was like, I want to sign you to death row, I kind of got shook.
Yeah.
And that's saying something to get Fredro Starr shook.
Yeah.
Cause yeah, no,
but that's one of those things, you know, I want you on the row. Whoa. but okay. I'm with Jay.
And that's what he said. He goes, I'm already signed to Def Jam. He goes, I was trying to figure my way out of this shit. And Suge was like, don't worry about that. I'll figure that shit out.
He said,
I know Jay. I know it. Russell. I'll take care of that. Ain't nothing to worry about. And then Fredro said that Pac made his move.
It says, King Shameek was there. Don't worry about it.
Pac was looking at me. He was giving me that side eye. He was not encouraging that shit. He's like, yeah, sign with Death Row. We got it popping. He said, I didn't hear none of that. He was quiet. He said, he gave me a look like, you don't want to do this, my brother. Stay where you at.
Yeah, that's the thing. If you are there with an artist on that label, somebody who you are friendly with or somebody you respect, somebody you know, and they're not encouraging you to say, yeah, come on over. This is where it's at.
That's a moment
to go, hey.
I have worked at a couple of different medical practices where friends of mine at other ones were like, hey, should I apply? And I'm like, sure you shouldn't.
That is a thing you could do.
You could.
I'm going to say that's a S, a K, and a J. So that's a nope.
Yeah, that's when you're like, yeah, you really shouldn't, as I shake my head violently from side to side. Fredro said that he then extricated himself from the conversation, and that was that.
I love that Fredro said he extricated himself. That's not a word that anyone uses on a regular basis.
No, but I could picture an Onyx rhyme now having extricated in it.
Yeah, but if Sticky's doing it, it probably rhymes with ejaculated, so.
And that would be why it's sticky.
Yes.
Just
his fingers.
Gross.
He got 10 sticky fingers.
And then the reason why he said he determined to stay on with Def Jam, because of loyalty to Jam Master Jay. Mm-hmm. And I'll never forget that we were the ones who told him that somebody was arrested for Jay's murder. He had not heard it until he was on with us because the news broke that day.
Yeah.
So I kind of feel like we shed a little light on him. So
what's shine your light?
Yeah. Then he says, my loyalty was to Jay. I would never even think about some shit like that unless Jay was with it, because Jay put me in the game. There was no reason to do some shit like that.
Yeah. If Jay found you, brought your group together, signed you, put you on his imprint, took care of you, and then you just up and leave. That's very different than if, you know, yeah, he found me, but he's been treating me like shit. He's been taking all our money. He's been, you know, not promoting us the way he should. If you got issue with your current situation,
then you have every right to look for a reason to get out. But if you're being treated well, no, you reward that loyalty.
Yeah.
This is not a whole lot of loyalty left, especially in the rap game. So
no.
And then Fred Rowe, of course, you know, he's retiring this year, too.
I did hear that. Yes.
He'd said that, you know, this is the last year for me. I'm retiring. Don't call me for no verses. I might do a show here and there, but 30 years of hip hop, you know, I'm retiring. All jokes in the side pocket. He goes, you're supposed to say I'm going to retire, and then you got to make that Michael Jordan comeback, but not me. So
I actually have, let me see where I put it. There's an album that came out, and it's in my record of the week list. I just haven't gotten to it yet. Now we're talking about Fredro, where Fredro produced all the albums or all the records on the album. And he put it out as, you know, it's listed as his album. I have so many records in this thing because I have to be prepared for when somebody goes, you already did that record. And I go, shit. And I have to take it out. Oh, Witch Doctor's still in there. That's supposed to be gone. Yeah, but he just did an album. And it was a couple months ago. And for Cranky, I just passed Word Burglar on my list. So just, you know, it is still on the list.
Word Burglar.
Yes. DJ ADF did an album like that, too. There, it's called Beats by Dro, Volume 1.
Oh, I like it.
Yeah.
And I like, I hope Dre doesn't give him shit about that.
No, he won't. He's a billionaire.
And I'm sure he probably gets along with him too. So,
yeah. But yeah. So Fredro did that. And then he's on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, like 9 of the 11 tracks.
Okay.
So it's, he did the beats and he's got a lot of features and people that he produced on a record. It's been on my list. It came out last year, December 8th, 2023 on 100 Mad Records.
So we'll have to give that a listen. Not ever playing Word Burglar. Next article. In the immortal words of, what was the guy's name on Saturday Night Live?
Tommy Flanagan.
Tommy Flanagan. That's right.
Actually, because his name was actually Flanagan. Tommy Flanagan, but that was the first lie he told.
Yes.
So he was the liar, was his character, but Tommy Flanagan was the character name.
Yeah, that's the ticket.
That's the guy right there with his wife.
Revolt.
Morgan Fairchild. Whom I've seen naked.
According to Revolt TV, pass.
Look, explains, so in order for him to even make it back into the show, it has to be something off the wall or entertaining.
We'll go with the former.
Okay.
Pass has explained how he has influenced Drake, The Weeknd, Young Thug, Travis Scott, and more.
Right. And if you had stopped right there, I would say, yes, he probably did influence all of those people probably quite heavily.
But you know, Pass can't stop there.
That's not, I don't believe that is his statement. That is the interpretation of the person writing the article.
If you are an interviewer, though, I mean, hell, we did it with DMC. We wound him up and let him go just to see where it happened.
Right. There's no reason, as you are doing an interview, there is no reason to speak until the person you're interviewing stops speaking. And this person seems like somebody who never stops speaking.
Pass on March 15th along with Ty Dolla Dolla Sign Ein. There's out. Another one.
You know, I didn't know that dude was like almost 50.
Who, Ty Dolla Sign Ein? Yeah. I know. I didn't either until
I always thought that he was a younger cat.
Sat down with Big Boy with a Y, same one we referenced before, not from Outkast, for an exclusive interview. And during their 80-minute
He's 41.
Still older than I thought.
Yes.
During their 80-minute conversation, of which probably Pass talked for 78.
Yes. There was an introduction, a how you doing, and off he went.
Pass spoke about the role he played in the careers of The Weeknd, Drake, and Future, among others.
And again, are you right ready? There, I'm in. I totally believe we're going to have a legitimate, sane conversation.
Have you ever listened to the Bill Cosby record where he talks about getting his tonsils out?
I don't know. The ice cream. Let's see.
Yes.
Yes.
There's a line in there right before they say you're going to have all the ice cream in the world you can eat. He says, are you ready for the lie? So after he says he's the roles he's played, are you ready for the lie? I done invented every style of music of the past 20 years.
And that's a quote.
That is a quote.
Yes.
I created this genre. I created the Weeknd genre. Travis Scott, Drake, I'ma go ahead and say it with all love. Future and Young Thug also, because of the auto-tune album. They added what it was to it.
So for the past 20 years, if there is a musical style that exists, it's because of Pass. He did it first. He created it.
Because it was all on 808s and Heartbreak back in 2008. Because of the whole auto-tune shit. Whether musically, fashion-wise, or in terms of cultural impact, Pass believes he has invented, influenced, and created everything involved with hip-hop.
Right. So we're going to just take auto-tune since he continues to mention that here. There was this guy named T-Pain. You may know him for his auto-tune ability.
I know him now more for his non-auto-tune ability because I did not realize that brother can sing.
Oh yeah. So his first album release was 2005.
Yep.
That is a couple years.
If I do the math, that's 3 years before 808s and Heartbreak.
Right.
But time and space are just concepts in the world of Pass.
What is time but an abstract concept of life?
Now, the people he mentioned do cite Pass as an inspiration.
I'm sure.
And influences, yes. I mean, The Weeknd says that, and I guess there was a song on his record that was co-written by Pass. In 2015, he said, yeah, I feel like I'm going through what he's been going through, reinventing himself, pushing the boundaries. He looks at himself as pop. He says, I'm a pop artist. You can't put me in one category. He's not pop. No. Drake, back in 2009, told MTV, before I ever got the chance to meet him, Pass shaped a lot of what I do as far as music goes. I'd even he go as far as style. To say he's the most influential person as far as a musician that I'd ever had in my life. Well, yeah, you sound just like a fucking Pass record.
He created the musical genre. That's why. Whatever that genre is.
That genre is fucking terrible. And with that being said,
yes,
Hip Hop Headlines is done. We are taking our first break of the day. And when we come back, it'll be time for a little bit of woo news and then some music on Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 529.
What's up, everybody? This is Kane from Death Wish Coffee Company. You are listening to Jamie and Bill on Mr. Throwback Thursday, the only place to get your hip-hop news. New school style. Old school. Let's go.
Here we go. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45.
30. 1, 2, 1, 2. What's good, yo? This is Ghostface straight from Staten Island, New York. And right about now, it's time for Woo News with Jamie and Bill. Y'all know what it is. Get it correct. Mr. Throwback Thursdays, Jamie and Bill. You know what I mean? On Woo News. That's what's going down right now. Y'all check this out. Exclusive. Peace.
The RZA. The GZA. Raekwon. Master Killer. Inspector Deck. You Got. Method Man. Ghostface Killer. An Old Dirty Bastard.
It's now time for Woo News with Mr. Throwback Thursday.
Jimmy, shimmy, y'all.
Welcome back, Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 529. It is indeed time for Woo News, and we have two pieces of Woo News for you this week.
As we woo, 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 yes.
As we normally woo, woo, woo. At least two, two, two.
Yes.
First one is Mr. Rocktober.
Ooh.
Now, anybody who knows sports or knows baseball.
Yes.
There is one player that has been known as Mr. October for years.
Yes.
The
even when the playoffs moved into November,
yes, still there is a different guy who is known as Mr. November.
There is, yes,
played for the same team,
uniform, yes,
same uniform, different numbers. Mm-hmm. One wore number 44, had his own candy bar.
He did, which I wish I could find.
I think you can get them on Amazon.
Are they from the 80s still, or is somebody remaking them?
I think they're remaking them.
Okay, good, because I would like to actually eat the candy bar, not just have it on my shelf.
I loved those things. Yes. When I was a kid. Didn't like the team, wasn't a fan of the player, loved the candy bar.
And the orange packaging.
Yes, and we're talking about Mr. October, Reginald Martinez Jackson.
Yes.
Reggie Jackson.
Who loved him some Billy Martin.
Yes, he did, as much as they argued. Apparently, Carmelo Anthony and the Kid Mero have a podcast called 7 p.m. in Brooklyn.
I hear everybody's got a podcast.
They give one to anybody. Mm-hmm. Hell, I have one.
What?
I do it with a friend of mine.
You should stop doing that, both of you.
We should, because it's terrible. Have you ever listened to it?
It's terrible.
It's awful.
It's just terrible.
But no, Carmelo Anthony was teammates as well with Charles Barkley at one point, I think. So there you have it. They recently had on Clifford Smith Jr., who is professionally known as
T-H-O-D, man.
Who has had success as an actor.
Yes.
And now he has a role that he would really love to play should the opportunity ever presented itself.
Well, take care,
good
Lion.
Morning, Lion. Take good care. You enjoy your St. Patrick's Day, and always, always great to see you.
Yes, yes.
Back to Method Man. He wants to play Reggie Jackson.
Woo.
And I could see it.
Yep. Hey, give me the mustache and the tinted glasses. And
I want to do a biopic of Reggie Jackson because when I lived in the Bronx, he was king.
He was.
Mr. October, man. I mean, he had a hell of a life, a hell of a career. Now, they picked him up from
Oakland,
the A's, yeah. Didn't they?
Yep.
And I think he ended up back in Oakland to finish probably, his career.
Yeah. I watched some issues in New York.
Yeah. He also did. He do two tours of duty with Baltimore, too.
That I don't remember.
I know he was on there at least once
in the late 70s. I was not following where people went, just that they left.
Right.
And in the 80s, the Yankees sucked. So it didn't mm-hmm. matter.
Because I think Catfish Hunter was also a Oakland A before he was a Yankee. Jim. So he says, I watched the documentary about Reggie because I already knew the kind of person he was. But watching that documentary opened a whole new mentality for me. And Reggie was just recently on a Mets broadcast in their booth talking with Keith Hernandez about their careers and stuff. And Reggie believes
comparing the mustaches.
Back then, yeah, they both had quality lip lettuce. Ain't no two ways about it. But
no Raleigh fingers, says, but you know,
no, was there?
Nah. Or Goose Gossage?
Nope. Reggie, by the way, thinks Keith should be in the Hall of Fame.
That's fair.
11 straight Gold Gloves.
Yeah,
you know. But he says, in addition to being a 14-time All-Star, 5-time World Series champion over his 21 years in the majors. Reggie also helped break the racial barrier in professional sports when he started out in the late 60s. Hmm. He says, when we look at baseball players, we like you white. It's just our assumption or ignorance or whatever. But that man was so much about his people. Not just about his people, but equal opportunities for black players in a game that's older than all of us, him included, where we weren't even invited to the table, let alone felt like we deserved a seat. So Meth also is still angling to get into the Marvel
Cinematic Universe. Yes.
So he wants to
he's in the Marvel extended universe because he was in Luke Cage.
Yeah, but he wants to be cast as Bishop in a future X-Men movie. I can
definitely see that.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, because he played himself in Luke Cage. So that doesn't quite count. Right. And because Luke Cage was not part of the MCU.
Right.
He's not there yet.
So what do you think we should we still talk about Cliff? We got one more article.
Oh, do we have more late than most definitely? Yes.
And you have titled it M-E-T-H-O-D fan.
Yes.
Hip-hop this, DX this, brings this us article this article
goes into some weird territory. Just so you know ahead of time, it starts off like ta-da-da. And then it goes, we can get talking about for the ladies.
Yeah. When I saw that where it went, I think it's cool when celebrities geek out over other celebrities still.
Yes. When I went to the Barclay Center for the UMTV rap show, I came around the stage and was standing like in the front of the stage, and KRS-One was performing, which the crazy thing about KRS-One performing is Shan had just performed before that because they ran Juice Crew out and Shan did the bridge, and then like 15 minutes later, Chris was doing the bridges over. It was an incredible night. I turned to the right of me and there's Cool Mo D.
I was going
to
say, you were telling me this story that Mo D was standing there and just said, fanboying out.
Yeah. He said, this is the greatest night ever. I'm like, this is fucking Cool Mo D. And he's as enamored with what's going on as I am, you know,
that shows that they love what they do.
Yeah. Red Alert said the same thing, but you know, Uncle Red always loves everything that's going on. So.
He does. Clifford Smith Jr., professionally known as
M-E-T-H-O-D, man,
has told Kevin Hart there are still some rappers
on his podcast.
Probably, yes. Gold Mines with Kevin Hart. Everybody's got one. Back on March 6th, he said there's still some artists that he geeks out over. And top of the list, the ladies love
James
Todd Smith. LL Cool J. Meth said that he feels that the Queen's Pioneer still doesn't get his just due. He says, I still fan out over LL. Let me tell you, 16 years old when he released his first single. Yes,
that's not mentioned enough. I mean, it is a known thing. It's not like they're trying to hide or obscure that it ever happened. But that accomplishment, the fucking radio album is incredible.
16 years old means he could be in the business for 45 years and still not reach retirement age.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yep.
So he says in the same interview, Kevin Hart showed respect to Ice-T as well because he fanboys out over Ice and
Ice-T, who is coming to your town.
Yes, and well, a little bit north of me. Going right up where Heather is.
Yeah.
Up at the Albany-Schenectady-Troy area.
Yes.
So
how did I not put that article in?
We are processing, hopefully, to try to get...
Yes, because, the email's been sent.
Yes.
And responded to at that.
And responded to, so we're waiting to hear from
basically from ICE's people.
I would love to go up there for that.
You're going
to
be the one going. So,
So if we get the okay, I will go up and, you know, Janelle loves SVU. Mm-hmm. She probably would go with me, but,
And then you can do a mini interview.
I would love to, if we could get back with him.
Yeah. Or at least get him on the show.
Yes. Get a drop.
Yes.
You know, Meth and Cool J collaborated on the song 4321,
yes,
which was on Phenomenon.
Mm-hmm.
and also credited with kicking off LL's beef with cannabis.
Yeah. That's why he bounced off of that song. Speaking of LL, I heard yesterday. Okay. You are very familiar with the song Candy with a K.
Mm-hmm. I
feel
good
about candy.
About candy.
Right. So I get in the.
Now a lady's drunk, gum drops jelly beans. Brothers beg for the legs. She's on the cheerleading team.
Yes, that's the song.
That album was so fucking good. Radio was good, but that Bigger and Deffer album was so fucking good.
It was Bigger and Deffer than the first one.
Than Radio.
Yes. So I hear this song on LL's radio station, Rock the Bells, and it's called Candy, and it's C-A-N-D-Y by LL Cool J.
Okay.
That's exactly what I said. I went, that's not right. And then I'm listening to it, and it's LL and New Edition.
Okay.
So you hear LL rapping, and then you hear Candy Girl. And it's them doing it. It's not like they just Z-Trip mixed it or something. It's updated New Edition.
Really? Yeah. Oh, I'm going to have to look for that. As a New Edition fan from a long time ago, you and I rocked out to some New Edition.
Oh, hell yeah. Here it is. It's that
Any Heartbreak was a great album.
Great album. I have. I'm going to have to write it down to edit this part out. It is on the Phenomenon album. So that's pertinent. It's LL, Ricky, and Ralph.
Yeah. I'm feeling that.
I'll edit this out.
Don't edit it out. This is important stuff, man.
It is topical. Not really Woo News topical, but by extension.
Yeah.
When you were 17 and I was 19, we fell deep in love, growing up in Queens. We didn't know a thing about love. We was innocent, sneaking on the doorstep to hug. Held you tightly and promised you the world.
I'm gonna jump ahead a little.
These butterflies in a while. How you grow up in innocence fade. We're afraid of the darkness and bitter memories. Lovers who crushed us through infidelity. I promise you I love you till the end. Always and forever since way back when. You're like candy, the world's sweetest friend. It tastes better now than you did back then.
You will always be my kid, my. One day we will start a family. You will always be my candy girl.
You'll be my candy girl forever.
All right, you know what? That's a.
This is one of those albums that I did not listen to. And I don't know if Phenomenon was the Puffy produced album. I'm gonna have to look at that. But that's the one that has 4-3-2-1 on it.
Mm-hmm.
So I
did not know that song existed.
Yeah, this album is exclusively produced by Sean Puffy Combs.
Wow. Yeah. He may be a shitty person, but he does have some talent to produce his booth.
Yeah, but that is one of those albums. It came out in, I think, 97. And that's one of those I missed due to deployment and deployment workups and things like that. So I never went back to it. Obviously, I knew 4-3-2-1 and the title track.
Something but a phenomenon, baby.
So I knew that one, but that's mm-hmm. not an album that I ever really went back and said, oh, I missed that album when it came out. Let me go catch up with it because,
you know, it's funny. I have it
lip-licking in my LL at that time.
Yeah, I have it in my library. I have all of these things in my iTunes mm-hmm. library, Apple Music library, which is so full of stuff that
it gets lost.
It would take me 6 months straight. Morning, noon, and night to listen to everything in mm-hmm. it. But now I may have to give that a listen within the next couple of days just because I haven't listened to it in a while.
I heard that one on Rock the Bells and I went, ooh.
I told you like last week or 2 weeks ago when I was driving out for a game, I just decided to put Shinehead on. I haven't listened to that album probably in 18 months.
Shinehead.
But I was just feeling it. And I was like, you know what? Who the cap fits?
Let them wear it. Yeah, the Mr. Throwback Thursday playlist, by the way, on Spotify,
it would take you 221 hours to listen to that.
Yes.
And I think I stopped making that after our 200th episode.
I think you did. Yes.
Oh, I can tell you there's 293 songs on it. So, which means after our 147th episode is the last time I put something on there.
Sounds good.
Yeah. So, you know, you guys should go listen to that.
Yeah. If you got 200 something hours to kill.
If you have nothing else to do, just put it on at work in the background.
Yeah. I'm not going to get into the rest of that article.
No.
Because
that's why I was giving you a chance to read it as I was.
It's just a little
talking about LL.
I
mean, there.
Look,
it was a big thing, and I did not bring that article up when it happened.
Don't look down on anybody for their lifestyle choices, but I am not going to sit here and compare the hotness of Method Man and LL Cool J.
No, there's an article people can read about it, and they can debate at work with their friends.
Yes. So if you want to read that article and compare that sort of stuff, go to MrThrowbackThursday.com. Click on the show notes for this episode
and tell your friends to do the same thing.
And you can discuss.
Yeah.
Who can, as the kids say, get it between LL and Method Man, and just, I don't know. I'm an MC Light guy. Light is a beautiful woman.
Yes.
It's just you, God.
I heard that guy.
Yeah, he's still not very good. Mm. That's not a story. Some That's just facts. Change. ODB.
Mm.
Even dead, better than you, God.
Yes.
There you have it. So
I had an article that I was going to throw in this week. It was about ODB's escape from prison. I was like, what? But it was a video on YouTube instead of an actual article. Yeah. So I was like, I'm not even going to watch that because then I'm going to want to talk about it and there's no article to support it. So I'm just going to move on. And I will just mention.
How long was the video?
I don't know.
I have to look for it.
Hold on.
Because, you know, that's the train wreck you have to witness, I think.
Yeah. No, it was Escape from Rehab. That's what it was.
Oh, Escape from Rehab. Okay.
Yeah. That's hospital doctors told him to stay in the hospital for examination, but he walked out. According to the FBI, ODB described the robbery as taking place. Oh, so it was. He was left a Brooklyn hospital after being shot during a robbery. He was shot in the left arm while asleep in bed. doctors told him to stay, and he got up and walked out. According to FBI, ODB described the robbery as taking place on July 1st, 98, when he woke up with a gun in his face, wrestled the attacker, and was shot. Yeah. It's an article from 1st of June, 1998 on NME.
NME brings you some stuff, man.
Yeah.
But
they don't bring you music.
No, they don't. We bring you music.
We do.
And we will start with a one and done that we have, because we have three things to bring you this week.
We have
one and done. We have a record of the week, and we have an old and a new.
And we have Bill Reed lyrics.
Yeah, but that's different. I don't sing. At least not on that. I do sing other. I do disclaim. One and done. Came to us October 11th, 1994.
A number.
Based off its length, it's kind of like an EP, but it's a 10-track EP.
It is, yes.
Running 36 minutes and 34 seconds on Epic Street and SME Records, produced by.
Which means SME, Sony Music Entertainment, is going to come after us and mute our video this week.
I'm sure.
Even though nobody's listened to this album since 1994.
The Bass Mechanics, which consist of 69 Boys and Quad City DJs, which I thought were all the same thing.
They are.
They basically are.
Yes.
The
95
first,
South.
This is a true one and done, because this is the first and only album by hip hop duo Diss and Dat, and it's called Bumpin'.
Yeah, Diss and Dat and Doom 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 Doom.
Diss and Dat with Bumpin'. I have 10 tracks on
As
this.
As do I.
There is no intro on this, but track what? Number one was actually
a hit
on Jock Jams Volume 2.
There you go. And that's why it has a million plays.
It is called Party.
If you don't want a party, then you should go home. We got this, that, and 6-9, they got it going on. Going to the party, who you gonna see?
say a nigga.
It's like being at a Doug Fresh show.
I...
Yeah, that Miami bass sound is huge on this. Track number two, one of the most controversial things I have ever seen, because we've never gotten the full answer as to whether it should be Whoomp or Whoot.
It's two different songs. It's two different artists.
Songs.
And this one's not a there.
No, this is Whoot. Here it is.
Yes.
As opposed to Whoomp. There it is. This is Whoot. Here it is. They're saying there, though.
Yeah.
Yep.
Now this is 94. Tag team I know was 93. Mm-hmm. What was the other one? Was it 69 Boys?
I think they did.
Oh no, they did Tootsie Roll.
Yeah, they did
95 South. Did Woot. There it is. Let's see when that's. That was also 1993. So I don't know. It's a Florida thing.
It is a Florida thing. Woot. Whoot.
Here, there.
Track number three. Do that thang.
Do that thing. Do that thing.
We're going to do it for my girl called this and that.
Do that thing. Do that thing, baby. Do that thing.
Ain't nothing but a party, y'all.
No, party was track one.
It was.
Track number four, Freak Me, Baby.
Wasn't that a song by Silk?
Yeah. Not a whole lot of original.
Rock it all night. Let's freak. Yeah.
Track number five is 50 seconds long. It's called Double D Bass.
Yeah.
That's some good bass, but how about we double D bass? Putting much bass all in your face.
Track number six. Let's play a little something for them cars that be bumping. Called Bumping. It's the title track.
Yo, check this. Just a little flavor for the 9-tray, 9-4. You know what I'm saying? For all y'all with them booming ass jeeps. So,
kick it. Little slick ring. Do 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 do.
I did pick up on that.
Yeah.
Track number seven, Colin Cleotis. Where Cleotis at? He at the barbecue with call? Ray Ray.
Yo, what's up? This is Shay Shay and Nene. Yo, we into a lot of dis and
Shay Shay
right
and Nene.
Now,
yeah, that's Ray Ray.
Make sure we get back to you. Peace. We out.
Hey, yo, this Mike. I'm just trying to call, and I'm going to have to cancel plans tonight because my grandmother, she's coming to town, and she wants to watch the wrestling.
Who it was?
Come on, Mike. Let's go.
All right, got to go. Bye.
Yo, I got something for him.
We're going to call Cleotis and have it out.
Track number 8.
It's called Holiday Inn?
No. It's called Hotel Motel.
And make things right.
Track number 9. There's got to be a Tina Turner or Rihanna reference in here somewhere, and I'm going to hell for saying that.
Probably.
Eat the cake anime. Just hit me. Huh?
Eat the cake anime.
Yeah, just hit me. Track number 9. Final track on the record, I guess, would be the second title track because sure. It is their name. It's Dis and Dat.
Hey, yo, won't you put something smooth in there? Something we can ride out to. True that.
Can you dig it?
Dis and Dat is known for the booty flow, but this time keep the tempo to the town low. Extra bass to it, along with the mellow track, they got a catchy little riff to it. So the diss and grab the mic and go to work. We'll hope to keep a knot in my Tony and Bird. Because I'm sure you never seen a girl of this demeanor turn out shows and rock arenas. I'm a versatile.
Verbo is for shit.
Sometimes I wear the tennis girl, sometimes I rock the sacky britches. Either way, you get your money's worth. But my feet don't hit the stage until I get my money first. But if they were all booked up, they some funky dope beats that the bass mechanics hooked up.
You let that one roll a little bit.
I did. Kind of like the sweet thing.
I think that's, to be honest with you, I think that was the only one with all the snippets that highlighted them as MCs.
Yeah, yeah.
So that was Bumpin' by Dis and Dat, your one and done for episode 529. There were 2 singles released off of this.
Well, I'm going to say Party is one of them.
Party was one of them.
And Freak Me Baby.
That was the second one. I'm shocked. Woot. There it is. Was not that. No. Only one of them charted. Party did not chart at all.
Really? Since that was a big Jock Jams one, it didn't.
Yeah, but the Jock Jams stuff never really charted. The albums always charted.
Right.
But Freak Me Baby peaked at number 60 on the Billboard Hot 100, which is their only single that charted. The album did chart on 2 charts, though. The top R&B albums, Billboard top R&B, it peaked at 53, and the top Heat Seekers, it peaked at 24.
Nice.
That is your one and done for episode 529, Bumpin' by Dis and Dat.
There's a lot more charting action than I would have assumed.
Me too, actually. I was relatively surprised by that. We have a brand new record for our record of the week. Brand spanking new.
Like a month old?
Like a month old, yes. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. Yeah, I have 18 as well. Sometimes on these new records, you have more than I do.
Look at that cranky seal of approval for this and
for
that.
For Bumpin'? It wasn't off. That's high praise from Cranky.
And the reason that this one isn't getting played until now is I didn't know it existed. I stumbled on it Friday when I started writing the show.
Really?
Yeah.
So the record of the week is Master Ace and Marco Polo. And the name of the record is Richmond Hill, which sounds like a very rich person's name.
Yeah. Richmond. Richmond Hill the third.
Yes. 18 tracks on the record, starting with a skit.
Yeah, there seem to be a bunch of them.
Called December 26th.
I was born in a little city just outside of Toronto the day after Christmas, a Boxing Day baby. This neighborhood, Richmond Hill, is where my parents decided to settle down and start a family.
Mr. Bruno, congratulations. She had a boy.
A boy? She had a boy? I'm gonna have a son.
She had a boy.
Track number two, Brooklyn Heights.
Spotify streams or a check from Tidal. It ain't dead, just check the vitals. Yo, it's still alive. Ain't no telling when the good guys will arrive. This ain't showing off your bands on Twitter live. This ain't what you thought it was. This ain't a radio hit or some shit made for the clubs. This ain't what you used to. This is Aftermath, Tongues, Death Squad, and the Juice Crew. It's not what you think it is.
Well, that's some name dropping on that.
Yeah, well, he was part of the Juice Crew.
Track number three, Certified.
Ace drops some nice lyrics on the symphony.
Ace is a good MC, man. That's why I said it's much underappreciated.
With or without the INC.
Certified 35 mil. Netflix chill, little batty lie still. Big body black truck with the wide grill. So black, low jack with the try still. Get money, money, make money, money, money. See niggas grinning, but ain't nothing funny. This is what I earn, can't take nothing from me. To whom it may concern, girl, break from the dummy. He ain't bringing nothing to
the... Track number four is a skit called Cartoons.
It's only 34 seconds, so we'll roll
Spelled C-A-R-T-U-N-E-S, yes. Like what we used to play, tunes, yes, in the car. And it goes into track number five, Hero.
Maybe it's a little something for them cars that be bumping.
I loved watching cartoons after school. G.I. Joe, Transformers, He-Man, the Smurfs, and Thundercats. Those are my favorites.
Marco. Hey, Marco. Turn that TV down. I can't hear myself think over here. My goodness.
All these ridiculous cartoon shows. Give me that remote. All right, give me the remote. Let me find something I watch as a kid. Something good. Something entertaining. All right, here we go.
Cartoons are not ridiculous, but quality entertainment.
Look, yes. Up in the sky. Could it be? It's a bird. It's a plane. No, it's Ace.
International man of mystery in black pajamas. Trust me, a man is history, and that's a promise. No escaping this. Beat his nuts. I'm baking this. Like Cacciatore, statutory, I'm raping this. Wear a mask and caping this, but keep the tights. You can't compare, so be prepared for some sleepless nights. My thick skin can withstand all these creatures' bites. They won't allow this black man to reach his heights, but I leap.
Track number six, Life Music. This kind of is life music for us, man. For most of our lives, anyway.
Yeah.
Dude, this record's solid.
It is.
This is a magnificent testament to different shit. Death in the air, raise your hands if you're sick of it. Poison in the Kool-Aid, everybody's sipping it. Life's what I hit you with, now you in the mix with it.
It was Flavor Aid, but...
Track number, what are we up to, seven?
Seven, yes.
Below the Clouds, because mine aren't numbered, so I had to ask.
Yes, you know, Below the Clouds, if this is sequel to Gangstars Above the Clouds.
I would have done, but clouds got in my...
Shout out to Google, inspect the deck.
It is, look at that.
Y'all dudes don't belong up here with us. Nah. Stay down there.
Thumb. All y'all fish chum dudes are dumb. Where you from? Matter of fact, tell me who you brung. We all number y'all bums like 2 to 1. This tobacco dip spit, y'all just chew some gum. I bring the pain like a sharp spike through the tongue. I'm Marshawn, 4 for 1 on a bruising run. You the type.
Gotta love a Marshawn Lynch reference.
Track number, what are we up to now? Eight?
We are in eight. Yes, it's a skit.
I can't keep track because I don't have numbers on mine. St. Roberts is the skit. How long is it? Because I don't have times
seconds,
either.
So we'll roll.
So we're going to go right into nine. Heat of the Moment, which is an Asia tune, it if is. I remember correctly, because I played it on Guitar Hero.
I didn't know who I was when I first got to St. Roberts Catholic High School. But it didn't take long for me to find out. That's where I really came into my own. And I don't mean that in a good way.
In the heat of the moment. In the heat of the moment.
In the hands of God, I'm nothing more than a piece of clay. I was looking for an OG to teach the way. I was dressed in my best like Easter Day. Walked in the Players Club, no Lisa Ray, no Bernie Mac, long journey back.
Track number 10, Jordan Theory.
Most of our lives, we've been hearing no, no. Most of our lives, it was no. You can't have that, you can't go. We can't afford that, no. Gold, diamonds, everybody shining. Bridge over troubled waters, Paul Simon. But that bridge is controlled by a troll. To cross over here, you gotta pay the toll. Only problem is the toll is your soul. A grip on reality here is hard to hold. Can't hit the dealership, cop that Maybach. Can't get the same Rolex the Drake got. Yet still, he's so material.
Track number 11, Money Problems. You know, this got a lot of plays on this record considering it just came out a month ago.
I think every song on here has more than that last album.
Uh-huh.
Your troubles and two for your problems. If we get some money, then maybe we can solve them. But it's hard to catch it, especially if you chase it. Y'all motherfuckers so basic. They said I need a big bag, bigger than I ever seen. And I need Corinthian suede and some leather mean. And I need some ornaments, real nice accoutrements. Never did I have it, but guess I'll get used to it. Then I'll get a bad bitch I could build a future with.
Track number 12 is a skit, runs about 33 seconds, called Scarborough, and then it goes into PPE, which is track number 13.
OPPE.
If you don't believe it when they say weed is a gateway drug,
yes, it is.
Stands for for me,
I can tell you firsthand, it's true. Because there I was, 2 years later in Scarborough, looking for a taste.
So it'd be OPPE. Other people's protective equipment.
I know where you're at.
Other people's personal protective
equipment.
Yes.
There you have it.
Okay, y'all looking to score? Well, tell me what you're looking for. You got a little bit of everything. Don't matter, you came to the right place, fam.
Shotguns, pushers, everywhere.
look, I see a lack of hope. Yeah. Putting strain on the heart from the cracking coat. Yeah. Another toke in the lungs, that tobacco smoke. Certain death at the bottom of that bag of dope. Gag and choke on my folk from around the way. Most running on the field don't know how to play. Life's hard and they can't beat the odds. They relying on God.
Track number 14, Outside In.
Yes, sir, Nipsey, this is indeed a banger. Is this one that you heard already? Because like I said, I just stumbled on this on Friday. Like there was no promotion. There was no articles about it that I may have seen. It just, there it was.
Yeah, and I'm glad you found it because this is a banger. Track number 15, Connections.
Connections.
That's exactly what I was thinking.
Try to do something nobody ever did before. I mean, even if they did, still, I'ma try to do it, try to do it.
Till I'm satisfied, I'm keeping my status high. Brit, listen kid, I don't care if you mad inside. Outside, upside down, Dr. Seuss was a bigot. Up to the days on the block and we used to get pivot. All time I was young and impressionable. Shit, back then I learned a lesson or two. 4, 6, 8, who do you appreciate? These rappers.
This shit is smooth.
It is.
Number 16. Plant-based. Might be the only plant-based thing I might enjoy. Dig that trumpet. I'll say that right off the bat.
Bon appetit, let's eat till the cipher's complete. And let's heal this life on the street. Yeah, the foundation of food and its nourishment. The building blocks that many flock and flourish with. Used to be I ain't eat these things, but them leafy greens, they keep me clean. Probably might sound like a preachy thing, but maybe I could reach these teams. Look, look, no soda, no white foods, the right moves. I might lose, now I ain't looking to fight dudes. Why beef, overplay the stroganoff, I'm going.
Track number 17 is a skit called December 25th. And how long is it?
40 seconds, so I'll play part of it.
Okay.
My mom and dad spent most of their life savings on making sure I got help. They even remortgaged their house. Because of them, I was able to leave addiction behind and never look back.
Where's your brother? Roberto, get down here and start opening gifts.
Here, honey, open this one. It's from your grandmother.
Didn't matter to me what was under that tree. They
already gave me. Last track on the record, number 18, All I Want.
All I want for Christmas is my freedom, my freedom. These common laws don't apply to me the way I read them. Before I ever join them, I'ma beat them, I'ma beat them. All I hear is empty promises, but I don't need them. All I want for Christmas is a little bit of honesty. Cause my industry be struggling with modesty. Another policy written on our lives. Labels getting richer as they listen to our cries. All I want for Christmas is the truth.
You can't handle the truth.
And that is a very, very good record of the week.
Yeah, it is.
For episode 529. Master Ace and Marco Polo with Richmond Hill. This one goes right into the fucking library. I'll
it
tell
should,
you that.
Yes.
Because it was just released a month ago, we don't have any kind of charting action or anything on it. No singles released or anything. But boy, that's going to get some heavy play within the next couple of weeks, I'm sure. Because, man, that's some solid stuff from one of the more underrated MCs we've ever talked about. Juice Crew member, Massa Ace.
Yes, yes.
So I am so glad you found that, man. I needed that this morning. You know, we've had a couple lately that were okay. Yeah, I remember this. And you know, that was an album that happened. This is an album that definitely happened because and smooth. And whoever did the production on this really did a nice
Polo,
job.
I think.
Probably, but wow, good record.
Yeah, when if you go back way back, to the beginning of this show, not this episode, this show, one of the things that we set out to do was to bring you new music from classic artists to let you know that they were still out there doing it. So when I come across an entire album, you know, there's a lot of singles that get released. We have an entire old to the new
playlist.
The majority of them never had album releases. They were just new singles that came out and then that was dropped, it.
Right. So
for Master Ace to put out an entire album, there's a lot of tracks on that record, and for it to all be good. And for me, someone who looks for this stuff almost on a daily basis, I look for new things that are going on, you know, it's just for the show, really. But for me to have missed it, let you know how little promotion there was or little notification or anything. I mean, and I follow Ace on social media too.
So Master Ace and Marco Polo together, Richmond Hill, your record of the week. Your one and done was Diss and Dat with Bumpin'. Your artist of the month for March, of 2024 are Fushnikins. And before we take our final break, we do have an old to the new that we hinted
at. We do.
It is from RBX featuring Rascass.
Friend of the show, Rascass.
It's called Hibernation. Brought to you by RBX, Rascass, and Mr. Throwback Thursday.
We out of hibernation. RBX. Jelly, bro. Dead arms like grizzly, NBA mascot, tank tops, Second Amendment, gunshots, can't stop, won't stop, rest in my man Kane, it's a cold world, I'm in the cut, Band-Aid, Bel-Air Rose gon' pop, drinking champagne, been a long time, I shouldn't have left doing a damn thing, post-pandemic, same hand as designer, Peter Pan, grown man, still acting like a minor, I'm attracted to many mansions and actresses' vaginas, boo cool women, giving the ass like yoga pants, Lululemon, yo boo boo, why they sleeping on Yogi, I'm about the bread and the cheese, that's a hoagie, I'm getting your basket, never asking, but something on my fucking 40, little nigga, UCLA color chinchilla, salmon swimming upstream, you meet the real killers, rest in peace D, rest in peace M, congrats to X-Rated, he signed his strange music, but this to RBX and gangsters that bang to it, east side rolling and acting insane to it. Hibernation.
All of a sudden, like, the sound is the move. Then the belly growl, like, got to get food. The streets stay active, but now, no doubt, hungry monsters, he eat them and shit them out. Then they say, Compton and Long Beach, you in trouble, but Long Beach and Carson probably bring Carson. Acts like a ghost gun, burn when it sprays. So fuck what they told you, you clowns gon' learn today. Brutal combination, narrator and Rascass. Nature of a threat, all that razzmatazz. Aim and shoot, that's simply last pass. Green hot hoes and lolos and all that jazz. Devil use all the way up, maximize. Little mama, hit the floor and shake your wings and thighs. Ain't no question who run the town. When the desperado step in the club, move around.
Hibernation.
Wake up, kiss up for me, God.
Hibernation.
Earthquake to break up, lay down for shake up.
Hibernation.
That was your old to the new RBX featuring Razzcast with Hibernation.
And
the track.
That it is. The
heavy track.
The album coming out, it's out right now on Bandcamp, and you can buy CDs right now. It'll be on streaming. They said soon. I'm not sure when soon is, but it's currently available on Bandcamp. The name of the album is Hibernation Shivers.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's what happens to bears when they come out of hibernation.
Yes.
So he's saying he's been reawakened after a long slumber, and this is his return.
Mm-hmm.
So I like the comparison.
Yeah, that was a good song. Good song. Like I said, heavy. So that was your old to the new. We are going to take our final break of the day. And when we come back, it will be time for Bill Reed's lyrics on Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 529.
Okay, and you listen to my boys Jamie and Bill on Mr. Throwback Thursdays. So let's make this happen.
What you say begins to know each other better.
That sounds good, but I don't think that I can let you.
I don't know, tell me, is it so? Do you get a kick out of telling brothers no?
The following segment of Bill Reed's lyrics is an educational discussion of artistic expression and creativity in modern music. This segment may contain explicit or offensive language. Sensitive individuals are discouraged from listening. The views and opinions within these lyrics are not necessarily those of Mr. Throwback Thursday or its hosts.
If you could understand that, you would know it's time for Bill Reed's lyrics, everybody. Welcome back to Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 529. And it is indeed time for Bill Reed's lyrics.
It is.
I will ask you kindly, sir, to hit me with some of them Bill Reed's lyrics.
Hit you, baby, one more time.
Ugh. I wasn't even a big fan of the first version of that song, so.
Do-do-do.
Do-do-do. Of course. Of course. We would go with the Miami bass sound.
Yeah, we had to stick with Miami.
There's no dollar sign in this name, though.
There is
so
not,
I think we've
no.
kind of I think we've exhausted all of those. All right, sir. Where am I going?
You're
going
to go down. I'm going to consider it verse two. There's a whole lot of little stuff happening.
Yeah. Who starts it?
Her.
Is it her?
Yeah.
OK, so what is the first word of it?
You.
So I'm going to keep going. Why do you constantly give me the female parts?
Because they play better for lyrics.
Okay, there you go. Because it's after her talking.
Yes, there's a whole lot of
actual verse.
Yeah.
Okay. So you, I am there.
All right. Then with no type of ado, Sesame Street Grover Stiley, whether nearer or further, we will cue the motherfucking piano.
You don't know, Nan, ho, don't bend the places I bend. Who can spend the grands that I spend? Fuck about five or six best friends, and you don't know, Nan, ho, That's off the chain, like me. That'll floss the thing, like me. Old lil awful thing, like me. You don't know, Nan, ho. That sell more ass than me. You know, Nan, ho. That'll make you come like me. Nickelback, you don't know, Nan, ho. That done tried all types of shit. Who quick to deep throat the dick and let another bitch straight lick the clit. Now you don't know, Nan Ho, that'll keep it wet like me. Make it come back to back like me. lick a Nickelback nutsack like me. Now you don't know Nan Ho. That'll ride the dick on the dime. Who love to fuck all the time. One who's pussy fatter than mine. Bitch, you don't know Nan Ho. And that, my friends, is why we disclaim.
Details.
I don't give a hoot about this Bill reading lyrics bollocks. Let's get back to the hip and the hop, shall we?
Hey, and there's our bollocks reference.
On that note, you have changed your hat.
In the future, we may talk more about bollocks.
We may. To see what the future holds.
Foreshadowing. Yes.
But in the meantime.
And it is time, as the hat has been switched,
to take us the fuck home.
Mr. Throwback Thursday, episode 529, brought to you in part by the world's strongest coffee, Deathwish Coffee. You can find them on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, deathwishcoffee.com, and our mugs.
Yes. In the mug.
Go to deathwishcoffee.com. Use the promo code TBT for 12% off as a one-time code.
One time.
And then every successive order after that, you can use the code throwback and save 10% at the world's strongest coffee, Deathwish Coffee. Don't forget to check out friends of the show, Def Rugs, defrugs.com, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, all at Def Rugs. Handmade, high quality, hip-hop themed rugs by the original Ruggie Fresh, Marshall Fox, and his business associate, the green-eyed bandit, Eric Sermon. Get yourself a Def Rug from defrugs.com. Our friend Heather Lent up in Schenectady, New York on J Street is the proprietor of the Bittersweet Candy Company, where she makes candy and chocolate that is handmade, small batch, different and
delicious.
Check them out on Facebook and order at bittersweetcandy.com. Use our code throwback and you will save 10% off your order at bittersweetcandy.com. Melted Mics, MLTDMICS.com. Hip hop themed t-shirts brought to you by the one and only Pumice Team and Dola.
Yes.
You can go to Melted Mics and get yourself a t-shirt and save 10% off of that t-shirt by using the promo code MR Throwback Thursday at checkout. MeltedMics.com. Let your t-shirt do the talking.
Yes, yes.
Etsy.com/shop/geeklikeyou, where the geek shall inherit the earth. Hip hop and pop culture themed items from the sick, twisted mind of Mr. Throwback Thursday and his sick, twisted wife, Mrs. Throwback Thursday. Go find all that at Etsy.com/shop/geeklikeyou. Don't forget social media network for the show, MrThrowbackThursday.com, where you can get all the show notes for every episode
and all your merchandise.
All your merchandise, go to the shop. There's some really cool stuff in the shop.
Yeah, I think we have the TBT 800 mugs left. I'm looking at my inventory right now. the TBT 800 mugs we have left. I think we have a couple of bowls left, like one or two.
Mm-hmm.
And there might be an anniversary mug or two. I'm not sure.
Okay.
Because they're all in these big Sunset Hill stoneware boxes.
You will have to find out, and you can go to MrThrowbackThursday.com and click on the shop link. It'll and you will see inventory. Everything what we have to order. You can also go there and leave us voice messages by clicking on the little microphone that says hit us up and we will play them on the air.
We will.
You can follow us on our socials on Twitter at @_MR_TBT and @Bill_MR_TBT.
And Bill actually used his show Twitter yesterday.
I did. Did you like that?
I did. I even pushed the button saying that I did like it.
Yes. I know that surprised you because I saw your Facebook post on it. And I said, well, we got to make sure that it gets spread because I know he reads Twitter. So we wished a very happy birthday to the one and only Flavor Flav yesterday. Yes.
That is the thing I'm going to try to start doing, by the way, is keeping up with current, you know, on this day stuff as much as I can.
You can go to the Facebook page, Mr. Throwback Thursday. Give that a like. And the home of the TBT Posse page. Give that a like as well. Give it a follow where you guys can talk amongst each other and make fun of me and to a lesser extent, Jamie. But it's usually mostly me.
That's because it's your fault.
It's always my fault. Check us out every Thursday morning at 10 a.m. Eastern on Fresh Radio at itsfreshradio.com and the Fresh Radio app for all of the phones available out there. Mm-hmm. We are on right after the All Request Thursday on Fresh Radio, which you can be a part of by tweeting your requests to @RealFreshRadio. You can send us emails as well to mrthrowbackthursday@gmail.com if you are so enamored to do so. It is time for shout-outs. Shout-outs this week, we are going to start with Gail Dunmeyer and Manny Baez and Sarah Henderson and John Henderson, Hugo Gonzalez, Sanket Patel, Teresa Lynn Simple Luxuries at teresalynns.com, Clay Arsenault, The Shrieking Warrior, Jennifer Buchanan, Jason Heath, Jessica Walker, Shane Hatley, Ricky Schnarr, Kenneth Elsfelder, who stuck around for a little bit, found out we weren't giving anything away for him to win today, and then left. Mr. Cranky Pants, Brian Hollenbeck, the legendary Kevin Van Buren, Robert Jeffroy, Kate Harvey, Catherine Liska, Ken Dwinell, and Wanda Calamia. They get mentioned every week because... I got five
on it. Or more.
And if you want to get your name mentioned every week, you can become a patron. Go to patreon.com/MRTBT or MrThrowbackThursday.com. There's a little link on there that says become a patron.
There is.
Don't forget our friends, as always, check out 1980s Now. It's such a great show.
It is.
1980s
they
Now
also with Will. Flava happy birthday yesterday.
They did, yes. 1980s Now with Will, Cat, and John. Check out Anthony, Imran, and the Rug Boy over at the Jock and Nerd podcast. Our friend Talkin' Ty
on her webpage,
BrooklynTyNYC.com, and a new episode available of What's the Word podcast with Brooklyn Ty NYC. Give that a listen to the hardest working turntablist in the world. As we've mentioned, is DJB on itsfreshradio.com. Get that app for your phones. You can also check us out on Wild One Radio at wildoneradio.com, 7 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, and all throughout the weekend as well. Don't forget to subscribe, rate, review, and all of that good stuff. We ask you to go and find us and share the good word with your friends. Tell them that you have a podcast that you think they should listen to if they like classic hip hop music, or if they just want to hear two idiots talk for about 2 hours.
Or wrestling or basketball or baseball or whatever else we happen to be talking about at the time.
Or dollar signs. Apparently, yes. that was a big thing today. This week. Go find us. Share the good word. Take good care of yourselves. Be safe today on St. Patrick's Day as we're recording. Mm-hmm. Don't become a statistic. I know it can be amateur night. So
at the Apollo,
eat a lot of good food. Drink responsibly. Wash your hands.
Wash your butt.
That's very important.
It is.
And until next time, keep it classic.
And like Cool Keith said, never laugh at you. Explain plans what to do. Machine guns on tour. Pajamas for your soft crew.
And always remember,
new school stale, old school fresh.